Hi everyone, welcome back to Information Economics. Today we will talk about a problem related to the forecasting decision at the retailer side. We will talk about a supply chain with a manufacturer and a retailer. That manufacturer may try to offer incentives for retailers to do forecasting or not to do forecasting. Okay, so there will be multiple players involved.There will be the supply chain contracting issue, there will be channel coordination issue, and there will be private information. So I think this particular lecture would be a good wrap-up for all the materials we have introduced in the first half of this semester. Okay, let me start. So in this video, I will talk about the introduction of the research question, and then we will talk about the model setting,And in particular, we will talk about how the two kinds of contracts, rebates and returns, may be used for inducing or discouraging retailer forecasting. Okay, we will talk about the problem in today's lecture. So let's talk about demand forecasting. We know in general, in a supply chain or in any supply system, supply-demand mismatch is always a big problem. This simply means you cannot fully predict what will be the demand. So you face an inventory decision, just like, for example, the news vendor problem. You want to store exactly what will be at the demand level, but of course that's impossible. You always face some stock out and some leftover. So that's always supply-demand mismatch. As a company,They may try to do forecasting so that they may better understand the demand, and then they may be able to minimize or to reduce supply-demand mismatch. Okay, so forecasting is definitely something that in practice firms try to do. In a supply system or a supply chain, obviously it's more reasonable for the retailer to do demand forecasting. Okay.Sometimes the manufacturers also do demand forecasting, but almost no retailer choose not to do forecasting to some degree, right? Because the retailer is the one that is forecasting, that is facing consumers, facing the market. The retailer is the one that makes the order decision, the stocking decision about how many products to put on their shelves, on their warehouses.So the retailer is really the guy that faced the most serious supply-demand mismatch problem, okay? And for the manufacturer, sometimes he does not need to do any forecasting if at his side the problem is just a make-to-order problem. Or it's also possible that the manufacturer is just an expert about producing products and it has nothing to do with the market, okay? So...More likely, the retailer is the one that can choose to do forecasting. In that case, the manufacturer may only try to incentivize or induce the retailer to do forecasting. Why? Why the manufacturer may need to do that? It's typically because the retailer is the one that pays for forecasting. If the retailer wants to do better forecasting,He may need to, for example, buy more advanced information systems. He may need to train their salespersons or train their market analysts with modern forecasting techniques and so on. Okay. The one that does the forecasting is the one that pays the cost. So if the cost is so high, the retailer may choose not to do that. And then if you are a manufacturer and you prefer the retailer to do forecasting, then...You may need to, for example, pay the forecasting cost for the retailer or something like that. So the manufacturer may only induce the retailer to do that. It's always impossible for you as a manufacturer to ask, to require the retailer to do forecasting. That's impossible. You can only try to induce or incentivize the retailer to do that. So here we can say thatWhether to do forecasting is the retailer's hidden action. Okay, or we say there is a moral hazard problem. The manufacturer may or may not observe whether the retailer does the forecasting or not. But in any case, this is non-contractable. So you know the retailer can treat this simply as a hidden action. And then the manufacturer somehow need to provide incentives for retailers to do this or do that. We will study how the forecasting cost affects the supply chain. Okay? Obviously, if the cost is small, then it's easier for the manufacturer to induce the retailer to do forecasting, or otherwise it may be hard. We will study how this cost affects the supply chain. We want to study whether it is always beneficial to induce forecasting. This problem may be answered at the system side, or at the retailer side, or at the manufacturer side. As a manufacturer, you may ask yourself whether you want to induce forecasting or not. There are obviously many different outcomes. Whether there is a forecasting action affects the system in many different perspectives, and here are two of them. If the retailer does forecasting, then the retailer or as a system as a whole can reduce supply-demand mismatch. From the system's perspective, the system basically will become more efficient. So the total channel profit would become larger, okay? But that does not mean the manufacturer can also earn more, because in that case, as long as the retailer forecasts, the retailer will get some market knowledge or get some market information, which will be privately observed by the retailer. So once the retailer does forecasting, the manufacturer will be at information disadvantage. There will be information asymmetry in the channel. Okay? So we want to ask whether it would be beneficial to induce forecasting. And if forecasting is beneficial, when should the manufacturer do that? And what is the most efficient way for the manufacturer to do that? That's the problem. So we will talk about how different kinds of contracts may be offered by the manufacturer as some kind of incentives. Okay? The only way that the manufacturer may affect the retailer's decision is by offering some contracts. In particular, we will talk about rebate contracts and return contracts. In previous lectures, we have introduced these two kinds of contracts. And also, there are others, right? There are others. But here, it's reasonable to focus on these two contracts, as we will tell you in a short time. These two contracts are somewhat opposite if we consider the retailer's forecasting decision. So, what are them? Under a rebate contract, the manufacturer pays a bonus to the retailer for each unit sold. So that means when you sell some product, you will earn more. And part of the earnings comes from the manufacturer. That means a rebate somehow encourage the retailer to do forecasting, right? Because by using a rebate contract, you are requiring your agent, you are requiring your retailer to become more accurate, because the risk of facing the supply-demand mismatch becomes higher. So once we offer a rebate contract, basically the retailer will have more incentive to do forecasting. On the other hand, if we offer a return contract, then the manufacturer will buy back unsold units. And that means the manufacturer offers an insurance to the retailer. And obviously, the retailer will have some incentives to not to do forecasting. Okay? So it's interesting to compare these two contracts in this demand forecasting problem in about how these two kinds of contracts affect the retailer's decision and which one is better than the other in general. Okay? So the manufacturer's problem may be which contract format is more beneficial, and for example, may maximize the manufacturer's expected profit. The study we introduced here has been done by Taylor and Shaw in this particular paper published in Management Science. Okay, so basically we are talking about this paper. Let me introduce more about the demand forecasting or about how this paper talks about demand forecasting. We will say there is a manufacturer and there is a retailer. And these two guys both face uncertain consumer demands. So if the retailer does not do forecasting, then their knowledge about the market will be the same. There is a unit production cost C and a unit retail price P. Okay, so these are just basic assumptions. Without forecasting, both of them think that the random demand is a random variable Dn, and that follows a cumulative distribution function CDF as f of n. Okay, so just to help you remind yourself, f of n x means the probability for your random demand to be less than or equal to small x. Okay, this is your CDF. If you decide the CDF, then you decide the distribution of this random demand. The retailer may do a forecasting with a forecasting cost k. That means if you do forecasting, you pay the forecasting cost k, and then the retailer will obtain a private demand signal denoted as s. S may have two values, either H or L. H means something that is optimistic, and L means something that is pessimistic. We will say that it's a high signal or a low signal. It's something like you do a market survey about you simply randomly select 1,000 potential consumers and ask them how do you like this product or not. And then according to their responses, you make some conclusions about whether the market condition is good or bad. Before we do the forecasting, we expect that with probability lambda, we will see a good signal. That's going to make the retailer optimistic. And then she will update her belief about the random market to another random variable DH with another CDF called f of h. Otherwise, with probability 1 minus lambda, the retailer is going to see an unfavorable signal. And then the retailer will become pessimistic and use another random function, random variable dl. We will assume that if you are optimistic, then your CDF fh would be smaller than FL. Keep in mind that FH tells you the probability. So for the probability for the demand to be smaller than X, FH is always smaller. So that means your demand is basically higher. And also, if you don't do forecasting, then your CDF should somehow be the combination of your high CDF and low CDF. Okay, before you do forecasting, this is the only thing you can expect. You know, the demand may either be high or low with these probabilities, but you just don't know whether it's high or low. You can do that only after you do the forecasting. Okay, so before forecasting, your demand function is Fn, and after forecasting, it will become either Fh or Fl. We will assume that capital F is strictly increasing for any possible demand function. Now let me write it as Fs. And also we define something called the 1 minus Fs of x as the right hand side, as the right tail probability of a CDF. But to give you more concrete ideas, let me provide a very simple example. Suppose we know that, according to our past experience, if tomorrow is a rainy day, demand would be uniform between 0 and 1. If tomorrow is a sunny day, it will become uniform between 0 and 2. Okay? That means they have their CDF like this. So let me try to draw it. This is 1, this is 2, and then for FL, it's something like this. Okay, this is FL. And then for FH, it's something like this. So you can see that FH is always below FL. Okay, that's the idea. And then we may say that the demand is simply depending on a random number theta. Theta decides the upper bound of the demand distribution, and theta may be either 1 or 2. And then lambda would be the probability for theta to be 2, and 1 minus lambda is the probability for theta to be 1. If the firm does not know theta, then all we can do is to somehow do a linear combination and form the no forecasting demand function. It will simply be, for example, something like this. It may be anything looking in this shape within this triangle for different values of lambda. Okay, so this is just a very simple example about you have FL, you have FH, and you have FN. Okay, this is just about demand forecasting. Before you do forecasting, you think it is in this way. After you do forecasting, you know it will be either FL or FH, and that's going to help you to do some ordering decisions. So let me summarize our research questions. Should the manufacturer induce the retailer to do forecasting? If so, how should the manufacturer design the offer? Which type of contracts, returns or rebate, is more beneficial for the manufacturer? And in any case, or under any equilibrium, we talk about efficiency, inefficiency. We talk about the incentive issues and how information asymmetry affect their behaviors in this particular problem. Okay, so that's the introduction of this problem. Thank you. Now let's describe the model that is set up for studying this problem. Okay, we will give you a model that describes their behaviors and their possible options, and that will be the topic in this particular video. So we know as the manufacturer, you may offer either a rebate contract or a return contract. Let's talk about rebate contract first. In general, the manufacturer may offer a rebate contract as a three tuple, okay, containing three elements, Q, R, and T. Q is the order quantity, R is the sales bonus per unit sales, and T is the fixed lump sum transfer payment. Okay, that means I offer you these three numbers, and then as a retailer, you choose to accept this contract or deny this contract. If you accept, then you're going to pay me in total T dollars, and then I will give you Q units. And then later, when you really sell the products, you're going to earn rebates according to the amount of products you sell. Okay? So this is what we define as a rebate contract. Please note that this is the most general form of a rebate contract. For example, we are not restricting ourselves to a wholesale price contract, right? We are allowed to offer, for example, Q is 10 and T is 100, and Q is 20 and T is 180. Then that's a quantity discount contract. Okay, we are allowed to do something like that. T may depend on Q and R in any format you like. Okay? Then only with this generality, we can somehow say that we are doing the optimal contract or optimal rebate contract. For return contract is very similar. Now it's again a three tuple, Q, B, and T. In this case, Q is again the order quantity, and the B is a buyback price, or buyback price that is paid to the retailer for every unit of unsold product. Okay, here we assume that we adapt for return, so all the units that are unsold can be returned. Okay, that's the assumption. And finally, T is the transfer payment again. So if the retailer accepts this contract, she pays me $T to get Q units, and then afterwards there is a buyback price, $P per unit. Still, the manufacturer is not restricted to sell the product as a wholesale price. T can be any function depending on Q and B as you like. Okay, this is the most general return contracts. So obviously here, we are formulating the problem in this way, for the manufacturer to offer a take it or leave it contract. Okay, I offer you something, choose it or not. The manufacturer is not allowing the retailer to order, to choose the order quantity by itself. But as we discussed in the previous lecture, there is really no difference between designing a payment function for the retailer to choose a quantity or this format. Okay? Designing this kind of offer and designing a payment function is basically equivalent. So discussing this is just enough. So as we mentioned, the manufacturer is offering a take it or leave it contract. Then the retailer can only accept or reject the contract. Okay, that's the only thing that the retailer can do facing these kinds of contracts. However, even though the retailer does not do an inventory decision, the retailer's information, or market information, may make the accept or reject decision more accurate. For example, you got an offer with a very high quantity, and for example, a high price. Then you may need to think about whether there will be a high demand. If you do forecasting and you see there will be a high demand, then you will tend to accept this offer. But if you do forecasting and see there will be a low demand, you will choose to deny this contract. Okay? So the retailer's information is still helpful to herself, so that as she will be able to make a more accurate, more beneficial decision about whether to accept the offer. Suppose we take the signal, the demand signal, into consideration, then we know the following. First, if the retailer does not forecast, then the retailer has no private information, and then in that case, a single contract would be enough. The manufacturer only need to offer a single contract for the retailer to choose or not to choose. Okay? So that's somewhat something related to the first best situation or complete information situation that we introduced in the previous lecture. Or if the retailer does demand forecasting and get a private signal S, then by revelation principle, we should offer a menu of contract that induce truth-telling. If we can do that, then the manufacturer may optimize its expected profit. Here, one key is that as S is binary, a menu of two contracts would be optimal. Okay? We want two types of retailers will choose different contracts. So there is no reason to offer three contracts, right? Because the retailer, one of them will choose this one, the other one will choose that one. No one is going to choose the third one. So we only need a menu of two contracts. And this is something you know as revelation principle. So, we're going to assume that the manufacturer cannot mix rebates and returns. So the manufacturer only need to offer either a rebate or a return. Okay? But later we will show you that mixing them does not make the manufacturer earn more money. The last thing I want to remind you is that the retailer determines whether to obtain private information. Right? The retailer can choose whether to do forecasting. And only after he does forecasting, there is private information. So this is a problem with the so-called endogenous adverse selection. Okay? If there is a private information, if there is private information, then we have an adverse selection problem. Then, whether there is an adverse selection problem depends on the player's decision. So we may or may not see adverse selection. We say this is endogenous adverse selection problem. The timing of this game is the following. At the first stage, the manufacturer decides an offer, either a rebate contract or a return contract, either a single contract or a menu of contracts. Anyway, the manufacturer makes the offer to the retailer. The retailer then decides whether to do forecasting or not. If the retailer does so, the retailer will privately observe the demand signal. Okay. Then the retailer will choose a contract or reject the offer based on her signal. Now, basically, this is why the retailer may want to do forecasting, because that information may help her to make more accurate decision, right? So the retailer can first observe the signal and then choose a contract or reject everything accordingly. Finally, demand will be realized and then payments will be made, either the returns or the rebates. We will see different kinds of payments, but anyway, everyone gets paid accordingly. The manufacturer will be able to induce the retailer to do forecasting or not. Okay? We don't really care about whether the retailer's forecasting action is private or not, because in equilibrium, the manufacturer can expect or anticipate whether that's going to happen or not. Finally, we invite you to think about alternative setting, which is not discussed in this paper, but you may use your intuition to think what's going to happen in this kind of setting. It's possible that the retailer does the forecasting only after choosing a contract. And that means the event sequence is 1, 3, 2, and 4. Okay? You may want to think about whether the retailer will forecast or not, how the manufacturer will offer a contract, and so on and so on. Or probably you want to do that after you watch all the videos. The retailer, another setting is that the retailer first does forecasting, and then the manufacturer offers contracts. Okay? Then that's 2, 1, 3, 4. The retailer forecasts first, and then the manufacturer offers a contract. Then you want to think about what's going to happen. So anyway, let's stick to the original timing. Then here, let's do a very simple analysis about the integrated system. Here, integrated system simply means one company controls the two parties, or the two parties collaborate to do the decision. In that case, the decision is just one, whether to do forecasting or not. In this case, this forecasting, this market information will directly decide the quantity, or will directly decide the production quantity. Okay, so production quantity is some kind of outcome of whether we do forecasting or not. As you know, these two things are the efficiency indicators, right? We don't care about the transfer. We don't care about returns or rebate credits, because we only care about those things that determines the efficiency of this system. and that's about the forecasting decision and the quantity decision. Suppose the system choose not to do forecasting. The system will simply try to solve this very basic news vendor problem. Okay? It's just so basic. So we can define optimal quantity as QNI, and that's going to satisfy the very common news vendor formula. Okay? And then if you plug in QNI into the system profit function, we can get the optimized expected season profit. Okay? This is just a news vendor problem. If the system choose to do forecasting, then the system will either see a high demand or a low demand. And the probability to see high demand and the low demand are lambda and 1 minus lambda, respectively. Then the system will be able to make offers or make decisions accordingly. I first see whether it is high demand or low demand, and then I choose my quantity accordingly. Right? Well, the system can do this. So in this case, there will be two separate quantity decisions, QH and QL. And the optimal quantity is that for either H or L, I choose my production quantity by looking at this news vendor formula. Okay? So this is really nothing special. The system simply solves either this one or that one news vendor problem. Suppose we do not require or we do not allow the system to adjust their quantities accordingly, then forecasting obviously will bring no benefits. The only thing that the retailers can the system can do is to choose a quantity to face the future uncertain result of forecasting. Then it will have nothing to do with the forecasting. It will not be efficient. It will not be optimal. So we can show that if forecasting is free, the system should always forecast. Or we should say that as long as we are allowed to set different values for different demand functions, that definitely will be better than doing no forecasting. Okay, this is very obvious, so I don't want to talk too much about it. If forecasting is free, then as a system, you always prefer to do forecasting so that you better understand the demand function, then you make more accurate decisions. However, forecasting requires a cost K, right? So whether we should forecast simply depends on what's the cost and benefit of running the forecasting. The cost is just K, and the benefit is how much we may earn additional to the non-forecasting profit. So the difference is just the threshold for we to decide, for us to decide whether we want to do forecasting or not. If the demand, if forecasting cost is smaller than the threshold or the performance gap, the system should do forecasting and produce one particular amount accordingly. Otherwise, the system should not do forecasting. It's not cost effective. And then the system should simply produce QNI to maximize the expected profit. Okay? So as an integrated system, we know what to do. Depending on the forecasting cost, if it is small enough, do forecasting. If it is too high, not to do forecasting. And then we have our quantity decision. These two things will become the efficiency indicators to be compared with the outcomes of rebates and return contracts. Okay, we will do that later. Thank you. Okay, so in general, the system is not integrated. So the manufacturer and the retailer are somewhat making their own decisions by themselves. Now the manufacturer really need to offer some contracts to the retailer. In this video, we talk about rebate contracts and what will be the equilibrium outcome of rebate contracts. So we will assume that the manufacturer will choose to offer a rebate contract. Under this choice, how should the manufacturer optimally design his offer? He will in general have two options. Either to offer a contract so that the retailer will choose to forecast, or to offer a contract so that the retailer will find it's better not to do forecasting. Okay, so the manufacturer knows that there are two possible outcomes. So we will first find the optimal outcome, optimal contracts in either case, and then we will make comparisons to really obtain the manufacturer's optimal contract design strategy. In any equilibrium, the retailer will accept a contract. Why? Because the manufacturer always has the chance to decrease T, the fixed payment, so that the retailer is willing to accept the contract. If the retailer does not accept the contract, the manufacturer will earn nothing. So in equilibrium, the retailer will be induced to accept at least one contract. Then we will denote this outcome as a function RR of SC. Small r means this is under rebate contract. Capital R means this is the retailer's expected profit. S is a signal, either H or L or N. N means non-forecasting. And C is a contract, which means that the retailer chooses either QN, RN, TN, or QH, RH, TH, or QL, RL, TL. Okay? So S is the retailer's type, and C is the retailer's choice. In either case, the retailer is going to face a random demand with his choice of quantities. With this expected sales, the retailer may earn retail sales revenue and the rebate bonus, but the retailer needs to pay TC as the payment to the manufacturer. Okay? In any case, this is the retailer's profit function. Suppose the manufacturer wants to drive the retailer not to do forecasting. In this case, as we mentioned, the manufacturer will only offer a single contract, which is denoted as QN, RN, and TN. Okay. Now, among all the rebate contracts that induce no forecasting, we want to know which one is optimal. Okay, which one is optimal? The good thing here is that because the retailer does not do forecasting, so there is no information asymmetry, then the only thing that the manufacturer need to worry about is that looking at this offer, it cannot be beneficial for the retailer to do forecasting. Okay, so we will see how to do this. Suppose the retailer accepts this offer and does not do forecasting. The retailer is going to earn RR of NN. Okay, here NN means the retailer's type is N. Okay, no forecasting, because the retailer does not forecast. And also the retailer choose the contract with no intended for the one who do not forecast. So we know that we will see this particular expected function, expected demand. Okay, with your type, the retailer will believe that the demand is simply DN, and with the choice of contracts, the retailer need to take RN, QN, and TN into its profit function. However, this is just one choice, right? The retailer may still choose to forecast, and then that forecast result can help her accept or reject the offer based on the signal. So if she forecasts, then the retailer will do the following. With probability lambda, the retailer will see a high demand. So that means the retailer's type will become type H. The retailer will see this as the expected profit. Okay? Or, with probability 1 minus lambda, the retailer will see a low demand, so the retailer's type becomes L. In either case, the retailer has the option to accept or reject the contract. To accept or to reject the contract. For example, if the retailer sees that the demand is very bad, then the retailer has the option not to select this offer because that offer may give the retailer a negative profit. Okay? So, with lambda and 1 minus lambda as the weight, this part is the expected profit. Then, we minus K from them is the expected net profit as the retailer's earning under this contract with no with forecasting. Okay, so obviously the retailer has this option or that option. The retailer will choose the one that is largest. So the manufacturer's problem would be that the manufacturer need to make sure that the retailer will be willing to become an N-type retailer. This no forecasting result should be better than do forecasting if the manufacturer wants to induce no forecasting. Okay, so this is some kind of IC constraints. Though here, this IC constraint is required because we have moral hazard problem. We need to use this function, use this constraint to drive the retailer's behavior, to drive the retailer's action instead of private information. I should say instead of having hidden information. Also, we need IR constraints. We need to make sure that the retailer is willing to accept this offer. If this offer is really accepted, then the manufacturer's earning is that the manufacturer gets this payment. The manufacturer pays the production cost. And in expectation, the manufacturer need to pay some amount as the rebate bonus. Okay? So we can see that by designing these three numbers, the manufacturer need to offer incentives for the retailer not to do forecasting. The incentive issue is always there. Okay? We have some technical assumptions. In problems like this, typically we may have some sign constraints on different variables. But for transfer, typically we assume it to be real numbers. And that means we don't restrict whether it's from the manufacturer to the retailer or from the retailer to the manufacturer. Either one may pay. But anyway, it's not very important. So for the previous problem, if we do a careful analysis, we will be able to solve that problem by finding the optimal rebate contract like this. The optimal rebate contract has three numbers, and depending on the different values of the forecasting cost, we have different optimal contracts. Okay, here the gamma function is defined as blah 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 or something like this. We can tell you that gamma is an increasing function in Q. Okay, when Q goes up, your gamma will go up, and also that means the gamma function and the inverse gamma function will be well defined. Here, this should be gamma. Okay, here we don't want to talk too much about the gamma function. Basically, it simply tells you that the optimal contract depends on K, and also even though the contract is very ugly, but it can be found, okay? Analytically, it can be found. What we care more is the property of this optimal rebate contract. So the first thing I want to tell you is that here, for different values of K, we have different, let's focus on quantity. We have two thresholds, The first one is this one. Okay. The second one is a larger one. Okay. When K is lower than the lower threshold, our optimal quantity is a fixed number. When K is greater than the upper threshold, our quantity will be another fixed number. Here, this is the pessimistic system optimal quantity. That's the production quantity when we think the demand is bad. This is the quantity when we have no idea about whether the demand is high or low. So obviously, the second one is higher. Okay, the second one is higher. Now, we have something here. And we know the gamma function is increasing in Q. So that means, okay, I forgot to tell you the y-axis is Q. So that means when Q goes up, your gamma value should also go up. So that's going to give you something like this. Okay? So we can say that when the forecasting cost increase, then basically the optimal order quantity or the quantity that we offer should also increase. When K goes up, Qn star should also goes up. That's something we can find. Okay? We need some explanations and intuitions about this. So let's try to do that. Okay, so the first thing we want to discuss is that there's no rebate that should be offered. Okay? In the optimal setting, there's no rebate. This answer, this is somewhat very obvious. As a manufacturer, I want to induce no forecasting. As long as I give a positive number to the rebate bonus, the retailer will get more incentive to do forecasting. And I am giving myself a hard time. So if I want that guy not to do forecasting, I should offer no rebate. Okay, so that's reasonable. Then is another thing that we find is about Q is increasing in K. As we mentioned in the previous slides, Q is increasing in K. Why? When K is large, it is easy to induce no forecasting. Because the retailer knows that the forecasting cost is very high. So the retailer itself has no strong incentive to do forecasting. So it would be easy to design a contract that induce no forecasting. When the manufacturer can implement the efficient quantity, that's going to happen when K is really large. Okay? That's going to happen when K is really large. Okay? Please note that this is the system optimal order quantity when K is large enough. Why? We say this system is decentralized. Okay, this system is decentralized. But if the manufacturer wants the retailer not to forecast, and the retailer himself also wants not to do forecast because the cost is so large, if K is large enough, then there is no incentive misalignment between these two players because both of them prefer no forecasting. Okay, then we can achieve system optimality, because there is no incentive misalignment, there is no private information, there is really nothing that we need to worry about. So we can implement the efficient quantity, and the retailer will be willing to accept that. If K is somewhat moderate within this region, then it's still not very hard to induce forecasting. But now, as the manufacturer need to reduce the quantity. Why? K is moderate, so somehow the retailer has some incentive to do forecasting. If you offer the retailer a very high quantity, then accepting that offer would be risky. Okay? And then the retailer will need a precise information about demand so that she will be able to make decision about acceptance or rejection. So when K is moderate, you need to cut down the quantity you offered to the retailer. When K is moderate, you need to cut down the quantity you offered so that you decrease the incentive for the retailer to do forecasting. Finally, if K is really so small, okay, smaller than the lower threshold, then from the manufacturer's perspective, it would be very hard to induce no forecasting because the forecasting is so cheap. It would be very hard for the manufacturer to prevent the retailer from being forecasting. Okay, so in this case, the manufacturer will need to leave some positive rents to the retailer by reducing T. So we can see that at here, the manufacturer has this term. This term is subtracted from the news vendor profit, the news vendor revenue term. So this means the manufacturer need to give the retailer some positive rents so that the retailer does not forecast. So it's very interesting to see that the retailer can earn some money when K is very small. Does that make sense? Basically, yes. Because if K is small, that means the retailer is stronger in making a forecasting because that is cheaper. Okay? So when the retailer is stronger, the retailer can basically earn more. So that's not very surprising. What's interesting is that the retailer may earn a positive rent, even though the retailer does not have private information. This is because the retailer has the threat of getting private information. So the retailer does not need to really get private information. As long as the retailer can have the threat of getting private information, the retailer can earn some rents. Whether the threat is strong depends on K. When K is large, even though the retailer has that option, we know the threat is very weak. So the manufacturer can be very mean to the retailer. But when K is small, then the threat is very strong or credible. The manufacturer need to be generous to the retailer so that the retailer does not really try to get the private information. Okay? Finally, we may verify that the manufacturer's expected profit increase in K, and this is obviously intuitive. I require myself to induce the retailer not to do forecasting. Okay? That can be done more easily if K is large. So when K is large, I am in a better situation. I can earn more money in expectation. Okay, so that's the end of the analysis of rebate contracts when the retailer when the manufacturer wants to induce no forecasting. In the next video, we will talk about the outcome of inducing forecasting and do a comparison. Thank you. Okay, suppose the manufacturer is still offering a rebate contract and the manufacturer now wants to induce forecasting. Then the retailer will have the private demand signal. So the manufacturer must offer a menu of two contracts, a high contract and a low contract, for the retailer to self-select. Okay? And then we expect that if the retailer sees a high demand signal, the retailer will choose the high contract. Otherwise, the retailer will choose the low contract. We need to make sure that our contract, our menu, is incentive compatible so that we may solve the problem to find the optimal menu. So now the manufacturer need to ensure four things. First, let me say it in this way. There will be four kinds of constraints. We know because the retailer has private information, we have the adverse selection problem. Right? So we have IC constraints and IR constraints. Not very surprising. And also because we have that moral hazard problem. Okay, we need to make sure that the retailer prefers forecasting. So for moral hazard, we will also have a set of IC and IR constraints. That's basically what we need to have. So in this case, the manufacturer will need to solve this optimization problem. The first two constraints are the IC constraints for adverse selection. For the retailer to choose the contract intended for him and for her after forecasting. So the retailer can see whether he is a high type or low type guy. If he is high type, we need to induce him to select the high contract. Otherwise, we need to induce him to select the low contract. Also, these two contracts must be good enough. So these are the IR constraints. And then lastly here, we are inducing forecasting. What's that? This is the expected profit under forecasting. If I find a good signal, I should choose the high contract. Otherwise, I will know that the demand is not very good. I will choose the low contract with a lower quantity. Okay? And then I need to pay for the cost. No matter what will be the outcome, I know this is my expected profit. This must be greater than doing no forecasting, but selecting the high contract. This should also be greater than doing no forecasting and select a low contract. Okay? So these two are the IC constraints to ensure forecasting. These two are the IC constraints for dealing with the moral hazard problem. Finally, we have one IR constraint for the moral hazard problem. So that problem is definitely somewhat complicated to solve. But anyway, if you read this paper, you can see there is still a way to solve this problem analytically. So we can still see we have an optimal solution. We know how to design the optimal rebate contract to induce forecasting. Okay, somewhat very complicated. But here, please let me highlight two things. For high demand guy, the outcome is efficient. For the low demand guy, there is no return. Let's try to see why. So we want to differentiate agents through contract design. So we need to provide incentives for them to tell the truth. Okay? How may we ensure that? Is that we need to first see what's the incentive for them to lie. Or between the two types of agent, who has the incentive to lie? Think about this. You are a retailer. If you see the demand signal and your manufacturer asks you whether you are having a good signal or a bad signal, you will always say there is a bad signal. Okay? You will always say that the product is so unpopular. There is no people want to buy this product. So that if you really want me to sell your product for you, you need to pay me a lot. Okay? There is no reason for you to say, hey, there is so much demand. All the people love your product. You don't need to pay me anything. I will sell the products and I will do all the work for you. Okay? You will never do that if you are the retailer. So we know it's the high type retailer that tends to pretend to be the low type retailer. Okay? This is something we can expect and we can interpret. So then that's why we will have the results like this. So for example, what's this? This basically is efficiency at top. Here, top is the guy that is more advantageous. Top is the guy that is observing the advantageous signal. It's the high type guy. Okay, it's the one that has the incentive to lie. The low type guy has no incentive to lie. So that piece of private information somehow is not profitable to him. But a high type guy will be profitable by seeing a high signal. So that's why we have QHI equals QH star instead of having QLI equals QL star, because we have efficiency at top but distortion at bottom. To see distortion at bottom is something here. Okay, RL is going to become zero while RH is positive. I shouldn't say it's distortion at bottom, but this shows that when we want to induce forecasting, then for the low contract, there should be no rebate, right? Why is that? Because if you offer a rebate, a positive rebate, to the low type retailer, then the high type retailer will has more incentive to pretend to select the low contract. Why? I suppose you are observing a good signal. That means you are optimistic about the demand. You think the demand is going to be high. There will be a lot of people coming to buy the product. If that's true, you always prefer a high bonus, high sales bonus, right? If you expect the demand to be high, you always prefer high bonus. So if we want to prevent the high type to mimic the low type, then we need to cut down the bonus for the low type and also cut down the quantity for the low type. So that's why there is no reason to offer any bonus to the low type, because any bonus to the low type simply increase the high type's incentive to mimic the low type. That's not good. And also, we should cut down the low type quantity. Again, it's the same thing. If you think the demand is high enough, then you will always prefer a high quantity because that's going to generate sales. So if we cut down the low quantity, that's going to help us induce truth telling. Okay, that's going to help us induce truth telling. So we will have efficiency at top, no rent at bottom, and also we will have monotonicity. This can all be verified, or analytically verified. And finally, we will have no rebate at the low contract. Okay, so now we have the optimal rebate contracts for inducing or not inducing forecasting. We will be able to do a comparison regarding these two options, and then we will decide whether the manufacturer wants to induce forecasting or not. So let's denote the outcome, the manufacturer's expected profit under inducing forecasting and under inducing no forecasting as a function of K, as a function of the forecasting cost. Then we know forecasting should be induced if and only if MF is greater than MN, right? We probably cannot fully characterize MF and MN in closed form because the problem is not so easy. But we can see the following two things. First, when K is 0, MF is greater than MN. And that's very simple. If there is no cost for forecasting, it would be very costly to prevent forecasting. So MN in this case would be small, because you need to design a very weird contract to induce no forecasting when forecasting cost is 0. So if there is no forecasting cost, you would prefer to induce forecasting. And also, when K goes up, inducing forecasting becomes harder, so MF is going to decrease. Also, when K goes up, MN is going to increase. Okay, so at the beginning, MF is greater than MN. and then MF will go down, while MN will go up. So at a certain place, we must have a threshold, okay, KR, such that if K is smaller than that, the manufacturer prefers to induce forecasting. Okay, this is intuitive because we should induce forecasting if and only if it is cost effective to do that. Okay, if and only if it's cost effective to do that. Then we can see a lot of interesting things with rebate contracts. So first, the manufacturer may prefer a retailer with a high forecasting cost, as here. So this graph or this figure is prepared with a particular numerical result or a numerical example. Okay, we can see that there is a cutoff, right? Below the cutoff, the manufacturer will induce forecasting. Above the cutoff, the manufacturer will induce no forecasting. Above the cutoff, basically the manufacturer will earn more when the cost becomes higher. Okay, so what does that mean? You are the principal, he is the agent. If his cost of forecasting is higher, and you prefer no forecasting, then it's very good. Because his ability of obtaining private information is weaker. He needs to pay more to obtain private information. Okay? Then, of course, you will earn more money because his threat just become weaker and weaker. So, as a manufacturer, we may prefer a retailer with a high forecasting cost. Typically, this is not surprising at all because you are somewhat competing with your retailer. If your competitor becomes weaker, it's possible for you to become happier. Okay, so that's some explanations. It's more interesting to see that even the retailer itself may also benefit from a high forecasting cost. Okay. Why? So again, we have the cutoff here. Below it, or below the cutoff, the manufacturer induced forecasting. Above the cutoff, the manufacturer induced no forecasting. Here, if the manufacturer tries to induce no forecasting, okay, then when K goes up, the retailer's profit is going to decrease and decrease because it is harder for the retailer to have a threat about obtaining private information. Okay, so when K goes up, the retailer's profit simply goes down if the manufacturer prefers no forecasting. Okay, but what happens to the case when the manufacturer wants to induce forecasting? If the manufacturer wants to induce forecasting, then the manufacturer need to compensate the retailer for doing that. That's why here, the retailer simply earn the same thing. Because those additional costs to do forecasting will be covered by the manufacturer. So the retailer will simply earn the same thing. If you go back to the previous slides, you will see the manufacturer's profit is a linearly decreasing function in this particular region. Okay, that's because the manufacturer is compensating the retailer for forecasting. Okay, and then when we go across this particular threshold, when K goes up from here to here, the retailer's profit jumps to a higher level. Okay, so that means the retailer would prefer to have a higher cost. Okay, that may be non-intuitive at some moment, but if you think about it more carefully, it can be understood. Because from here to here, the manufacturer's preference changes. The manufacturer finds it less profitable to induce forecasting. And that's why when the retailer has a higher cost, she can earn more. Okay? Because the manufacturer's preference simply changes. So that's why the cost, the profit function here is uncontinuous. Okay, so when we have a decentralized system, and when we have some discrete choices at either this player or that player, we sometimes see this kind of profit functions. The last thing we want to address is that rebate contract unfortunately cannot coordinate the supply chain. So what does that mean? We see this based on the forecasting decision. There is a threshold that under which the manufacturer prefers forecasting, and above it, the manufacturer prefers no forecasting. There is another threshold that is that describes the preference of the system. Okay? And because the two thresholds are in general different, so there will be a region, okay, the region here, so that the manufacturer prefers forecasting, but the system does not. And the system has found it not cost effective to do forecasting in this region, but the manufacturer thinks in a different way. The manufacturer still finds it better to induce forecasting. Okay, so this can be viewed as an incentive misalignment between the manufacturer and the channel. And that's how the integrated system and the decentralized system would somewhat be different. The integrated system profit is this line. And the system profit under rebate is this line. Okay? A system profit under rebate is this line. So we can see when K is very large, the system, the decentralized system is efficient, okay? Because we should not forecast, and both the manufacturer and the retailer agree about that. So no one wants to do forecasting, and then there is no private information, there is no moral hazard, everything is fine. Otherwise, as long as the K is not so high, there will be some distortion about the system profit, and the system is not efficient. Okay, the system is not efficient. The channel is not coordinated. Okay. So, a brief summary about return rebate contracts. The manufacturer should not blindly try to find retailers with low forecasting cost. It's not always a good idea to collaborate with a strong guy, because that strong guy may easily get information advantage and hurt yourself. Okay? Also, the retailer should not blindly try to reduce the forecasting cost, especially when the reduction across the threshold KR. We know things may change significantly at that point. In practice, a manufacturer may try to reduce a retailer's forecasting cost. For example, the manufacturer may simply buy a new information system and install it to the retailer's site as a gift. Or the manufacturer may share some product information with the retailer. The manufacturer may choose to do something to reduce the retailer's forecasting cost. But if you are the manufacturer, you should try to do that only when the retailer is already having a low cost. When the retailer's cost is low enough, you prefer that guy to do forecasting. Then there is some reason for you to help him improve his forecasting capability. If you prefer the retailer not to do forecasting, then reducing its forecasting cost is simply hurting yourself. Okay? Finally, all these conclusions are made when the manufacturer is restricted to rebate contracts. We need to also analyze the return contracts. We need to also analyze the optimal contracts, because no one says a rebate contract is optimal, right? Maybe, for example, the return contract is more beneficial. Then we don't really care about rebate contract. Here, we went through some analysis, and the outcome seems to be very ugly. Okay, those formulas seems to be very ugly, but we do not try to train you to become those kind of mathematicians that can solve problems like this. But please try your best to understand the intuitions behind those solutions. Why we have, for example, efficiency at top. Why sometimes the rebate should be zero. Why this, why that, why this, why that. Everything behind those symbols has some intuitions and implications. And we may even deliver some managerial insights through our analysis. Being able to interpret and understanding those intuitions is the important thing in this course. Thank you. Okay, now is our last video. We want to complete our analysis by analyzing what's going to happen when the manufacturer offers a return contract. Suppose the manufacturer offers a return contract. Again, there are two options, to induce or not to induce the retailer to do forecasting. Suppose the manufacturer has decided one of the two options, then in any equilibrium, the retailer will still accept a contract. Then we can describe the retailer's expected profit in this way. Again, S is the retailer's type or signal. C is the contract selected by the retailer. And once this has been selected, the retailer is going to face, again, the random demand based on his signal. And this is the expected sales revenue, plus the expected return credits earned from the manufacturer. Okay, this is the leftover. If the leftover is positive, we earn some return credits. And finally, there is a payment from the manufacturer, from the retailer to the manufacturer. Okay, this is the retailer's profit function. So if the manufacturer wants to induce no forecasting, there will be no information asymmetry. I should say there will be no hidden information. And then we should offer a single contract, Q1, BN, TN, because a single contract is sufficient. Now, suppose we want to offer a return contract to induce no forecasting. What return contract will be optimal? Surprisingly, we only need to offer a full insurance or a full return contract. What's that? QBT should be set to be Q, P, and P times Q. I'm going to sell you Q units, and I'm going to allow you to return at the retail price P. Based on that, now I'm going to charge you P times Q in advance. So if you are a retailer, what do you think about this contract? You have full insurance because your return credit is just P. So it has nothing different for you to sell a unit or to return a unit. Also, you know at this moment when you get Q units, you pay PQ dollars. So it seems that the wholesale price is just P. Okay? So you pay P dollars for each unit to get the product. And then no matter you sell it or to return it, you still get P units and P dollars. So this is just a full return contract, and you feel it's just like doing all the efforts for free to the manufacturer. Okay? So if this is really a return contract, a full return contract, the retailer will be willing to accept it and earn nothing. Okay? For this return contract, the retailer earns nothing. Okay, actually you have observed it 2 weeks ago. And then if the manufacturer can extract all the surplus from the retailer, the manufacturer needs to simply offer the efficient quantity QI. And then the optimal return contract would be, first, find the system efficient quantity, QNI, and then set the return credit to be P. And then the total payment should be P times QNI. With this particular contract, the retailer obviously has no incentive to forecast. because the retailer now can earn nothing. And then the retailer, if the retailer does forecasting, the retailer simply earns less. Because no matter what's happening, no matter what's the demand realization, the retailer will simply earn zero from its operations. Then if the retailer pays K dollars for forecasting, the retailer simply earns less. So that's why if we offer a full return contract, the first good thing is that the retailer has no incentive to forecast. And the second thing is the manufacturer can earn everything he wants to earn. If the manufacturer wants to induce forecasting, then the problem would become more complicated. Now, the manufacturer needs to offer two contracts to optimize this problem. Here, the constraints are very similar to the case with rebate contracts under forecasting. Okay, so we have IC constraints for adverse selection, IR constraints for adverse selection, IC constraints for moral hazard, and IR constraint for moral hazard. Once we have these constraints, we know with probability lambda, we will see a high type retailer. He's going to choose TH, QH, and BH. This will be my expected profit. With probability 1 minus lambda, I will see a low type retailer, and this is my expected profit. I want to solve the problem here. Interestingly, now, the optimal return contract to induce forecasting is here. Okay, for the low type guy, we simply offer it a full return contract. Okay, but for the high type guy, we will offer it a no return contract. A no return contract. Let's try to tell you why this is the case. If you are the retailer and if you see a low demand signal, then you become pessimistic, right? You expect the demand to be very small. So that's why you would prefer to have an insurance. You would prefer to have a high return credit. On the other hand, if you are a high type, you see a good demand signal, then it's not very valuable for you to have a return credit. So you would be willing to accept a contract with no return credit in exchange for example, a reduced payment or a larger quantity. Okay? So basically, if we want to induce truth telling, we give each agent what they want. Pessimistic guys prefer high return credit. That's why we have this. Optimistic guys does not need a return credit. So that's why we have this. Okay? So the manufacturer will offer a no return or full return contracts to the optimistic or pessimistic retailer. Here, another interesting that we can see is we have efficiency at bottom instead of efficiency at top. Okay? And also we can see that in this case, the retailer, the low-type retailer is going to earn no rent, but the high-type retailer is going to earn some rent. So that's why we say the high-type guy is still the one at bottom, and the low-type one is the one at the bottom. Okay, so why do we have efficiency at bottom here? Well, the first thing is that this is not violating the fact that we should always have efficiency at top when we are talking about pure adverse selection problems. If we have a pure adverse selection problem, then we always have efficiency at top. Now, this will definitely be true. But because here we have an adverse selection plus moral hazard problem, so we will not have any guarantee on efficiency at the top. Okay? So we see efficiency at the bottom. This is not impossible. Then we still need to understand why in this case it is better to distort the high contract instead of distorting the low contract. So let's try to understand this. What we want to do here is that we need to prevent the retailer from doing forecasting and also selecting the high contract. Oh, don't forget that we offer two contracts to the retailer, a high contract and a low contract. Oh, high contracts here, low contracts here. The retailer has the option of not to do forecasting and then select either contract, right?If we simply have efficiency at top, then this thing is going to be the system optimal offer. We can show easily that the retailer does not need to do forecasting, and the retailer can simply choose the offer here, and then the retailer can earn a positive amount. Then that's not good, because then the retailer will do not forecast.The retailer will not forecast. And also in this case, if we want to either distort the low contract or to distort the high contract, upward distorting QH would be effective to discouraging forecasting. Why? Because a high quantity here is putting more risk on the retailer. If you want to order more,You need to be quite confident. You need to be quite optimistic so that it is a good idea for you to choose a very, very high quantity. So the best thing to do is to increase the high quantity. Okay, to increase the high quantity so that if the retailer wants to select the high contract, he must forecast and get a high signal. Otherwise, he will not be confident about doing that. We can see thatOriginally is QHI, this is the system optimal or the efficient high contract quantity. But we are doing a maximization, selecting the maximum between this number and another number. So QH star will simply become the same or larger than the efficient level. So that's an upward distortion. Okay, so at the low contract side, it's a full return.The retailer earns nothing. At the high contract side, it's an upward distortion on the retailer's quantity. So we can still show that the retailer will earn nothing when the manufacturer wants to induce forecasting. So this result would somewhat be very surprising. The retailer is induced to do forecasting. So the retailer gets private information. But here, that private information is not going to help the retailer earn information rent. Okay? Why? The retailer may earn rent only if the retailer can mimic another type when she is actually of this type. So previously we know,The retailer is beneficial if she observes a high demand signal. Okay? If the retailer is a high type retailer, she has the power, she has the option to pretend to be the low type. And that's basically typically why the retailer can earn a positive information rent, because that piece of information is advantageous. But the interesting thing is that in this case,The retailer will earn nothing under the full return contract. The full return contract has been offered to the low type consumer, right? Has been offered to the low type consumer. And that full return contract is so powerful. It has nothing to do with the demand realization. It has nothing to do with the demand distribution. Whatever you think about the demand,As long as you select the full return contract, you earn nothing in expectation. Okay? So the retailer, the high type retailer, will really has no incentive to pretend, to lie, and say that she is of low type. Then the retailer really has no information advantage. The low type guy has no incentive to lie and say he is of a high type. The high type guy also has no incentive.To lie and say she is of a low type. So the retailer will have no informational advantage at all. and that's why the manufacturer will be able to earn everything. Then we now can try to ask whether the return contract can coordinate the system, and the answer is yes. The answer is yes. We can still show you that there is a unique threshold that the manufacturer would prefer to induce forecasting when K is smaller than this particular threshold. The interesting thing is that that threshold will always be identical to the threshold for the integrated system. Okay? So, if we are doing an optimal return contract, then the two thresholds will always be identical. The two thresholds will always be identical. And then, the manufacturer's expected profit will be just the integrated system expected profit. That also shows that the return contract is just optimal. The manufacturer cannot find anything that is better than that optimal return contract, because the manufacturer has successfully coordinated the system and take everything away from the retailer. So the manufacturer is really at the best outcome. Let's try to understand this intuition. How come under a rebate contract, the system can be efficient? The key is that this full return contract is so powerful. Okay? With the full return contract, the manufacturer, the principal, can actually take away all the informational advantage of the agent. Okay? So the manufacturer only need to offer a full return contract to a type N or type L retailer. And this particular action is going to make the high type guy lose all the informational advantage. And with that, all the manufacturer needs to worry about is to induce forecasting or not. So that means screening is no longer a problem. You don't need to worry about those guys will lie according to their hidden information. Okay, adverse selection is not a problem anymore. Inducing information acquisition is. Okay, the moral hazard problem is the only thing that remains. You need to make sure that if the system should induce forecasting, then the manufacturer also wants that. What's interesting is that the retailer's threat of forecasting would be credible only if K is small. You are a retailer. If your cost is so high, then it's not credible for you to threatening that you want to do forecasting. Okay? So the retailer's threat of forecasting is credible only if K is small. But when K is small, the manufacturer also prefers the retailer to forecast, right? So the threat would be strong. The threat would be strong only when the manufacturer does not care about it. Well, basically, this is just saying that the manufacturer and the retailer somehow is thinking about the same thing. The manufacturer prefers to induce forecasting when K is small, because it's easier to do that. And then the retailer is also preferring to do that when K is small. So as long as there is no adverse selection, there is also no moral hazard, because the return contract can eliminate this screening problem. So the remaining moral hazard problem is not a big deal and can be fully eliminated by the manufacturer's return contract. Okay? The key difference between rebate and return is that screening is a problem when we use the rebate contract. When the manufacturer uses the rebate contract, we still have that screening problem, we still have adverse selection, and that's why that moral hazard problem is also still there. Okay, so this is probably the first time that we use our knowledge about information asymmetry to study a somewhat complicated problem rigorously. Okay, So I hope you will try to think about all the intuitions and implications before you come to the class. Let me do a conclusion. A supply chain in which the retailer may do forecasting or not is studied. Okay? And we consider two types of contracts, rebates or returns. We show that for the manufacturer, return is optimal. And we really go into the details to understand why return contracts are optimal. It's because the full return contract can eliminate the screening problem. The return contract can take away the informational advantage possessed by the retailer. And it's because that the return contract is more effective to deal with information asymmetry. That's why it is optimal. It is better. Okay? So that's the end of today's lecture. Returns, rebates, supply chain contracting, channel coordination, two type model, screening, private information, hidden information, hidden action. Please try to think about all of them so that you may fully understand everything covered up to this week. Thank you.